Let's have a word of prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness in our hearts and in our lives. It's so good to be children of God, born again by the precious word of God and the Spirit of God, redeemed by the precious blood of Christ, washed clean by the cleansing flow of the powerful blood of Jesus. So we are in the family of God, and we thank you for that. We thank you that we can not only call you God, but Heavenly Father through our Lord Jesus Christ. Tonight, as we gather together in this way, some here in person, some watching over the internet and YouTube and Zoom, and some will be watching the video later, possibly, we thank you for your goodness in each heart, all of our lives, families. We thank you for your goodness, the Word of God producing results by the Spirit of God, and we give you all of the praise and the glory. We thank you for the Word of God tonight as we gather together to speak of you, to look into your Word, to hear of you and from you. We ask you for the Spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you, the eyes of our understanding enlightened. And I pray that not only would we be listening and receptive to your word and your spirit, I pray that we would be doers of the word and not hearers only, recipients of that which you have provided, being fruitful for the glory of God, your glory, but also for our blessing. And for each of these benefits and blessings, we give you the praise and the glory. For it is in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray this prayer and believe that these things are so. It is in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Someone have a word of testimony? Say something good about Jesus? A question, a comment, a topic of discussion? Brother Tony, I heard, I read. It could be someone else's ministry. Could be something you heard from me. Explain a little further or go over that again, or a question or a comment. A Bible topic. Someone recently asked me the same question. I didn't say an adamant no, but I could have, and I like that. But what I said just recently, a few days ago, within the last week or so maybe, I said very similar. I couldn't care less sometimes what the doctor's report says, whether it's good or bad. If it's good, it confirms what I believe. If it's bad, I'm just going to keep going and believing what I believe, and eventually it's going to be good. But I couldn't care less. I mean, let it confirm the Word of God, but if it comes back and it's not yet there, I just keep going. It won't move me. It won't shake me. And so that's what I encourage that person to do. Plus, if you've already had the test, and now you're waiting on the results. It's too late to pray now because the test has already been done. I mean, he's not going to lie and change the results for whatever they were. That's not going to be consistent with faith in the Word of God anyway. You've already had the test. You just haven't gotten the results yet. And so your faith isn't going to change the past anyway. But it doesn't matter what the doctor's results are. I mean, when they're good, they confirm. And then you can give the testimony, and God wants the testimony, and we do too. But he also wants us to learn faith, learn how to stand, and learn how to not be moved by what we see. And so as we grow, and you hear me often say God wants his children to grow, even in the earthly ministry of Jesus, he was teaching a new message to new people. Some things were instant. I've said very often to ministers that travel to foreign countries, other countries, and preaching the gospel to people that have never heard it, they come and they tell me, and I hear their testimonies and their ministry of signs, wonders, and mighty deeds. And when I can, I tell them, now you won't keep getting that. If you go back 5 years later and 10 years later, you won't have the same results. And to some of them, it seems like quite a shock. But yet, I can ask them, isn't that what you're experiencing? I mean, just be honest. Are you getting the same results 10 years later that you got 10 years ago, preaching in the same area, going to the same churches or the same areas? And if they'd be honest, they might tell about, because new people are always coming in sometimes, And they may tell of the results they get with the new people. But now let's talk about the ones that were there 10 years ago that are there again. Are you getting instant healings and miracles with them? And if they just be honest and tell about, a lot of ministers tell about the miracles, but they don't tell about the failures. They tell about when it worked, but they don't tell about when it didn't work. I like to look at when it didn't work, and let's look at that and see if we can fix it or learn from it. And so we're not going to get the same results preaching to people that have heard it, because God wants us to grow. And there's a place where he wants us to stop being moved by what the doctor says and what the body says and what the natural says, to not be moved. Paul was bit by that snake, and he shook it off in the fire and felt no harm. And Peter cut off that soldier's ear. Jesus put it back on. And just either way, it's in the natural. We may be naturally trained to respond a certain way, but the more we walk in the supernatural, that natural training takes the back seat. And there's another training that comes to the forefront. And I'll just shake that off in the fire and feel no harm and let everybody watch, and it'll be a testimony. And well, the doctor says this is incurable. Well, that's the doctor, not the word of God. Well, the doctor says you still have it. Everybody keep praying. And you hear me say this often. I tell people no. They'll come, you know, to church services, and they'll say, well, I went to the doctor this week. He says I still have it. Everybody keep praying. And I just want to shout out, why? I thought we already prayed. What changed? Didn't we pray prayers of faith and believing? Aren't we still going to believe those same scriptures that we said we believed before? What's changed? We're not going to keep praying any differently than we were praying. And what we were praying was prayers of thanksgiving that God's word is working. Thank you, Father, for it. And we're going to keep praying that. The doctor's report does not change anything, but when it's a good report, it confirms. So we want the good report, and then we tell the testimony. But until then, we don't change. It doesn't move us. It doesn't change us. And we don't need to pray about it or pray for it. Don't need to pray about it. Don't need to pray for it. And so few preachers are teaching this. And I didn't, you know, I would have assumed Keith Moore would, because I know his ministry. But I'm so glad to hear that he's saying that. There are so few that are. And it needs to be heard. One thing that the Lord said to Brother Hagin is, go teach my people what I've taught you. Go teach my people faith. Well, I think a few heard it. But so many people still need to hear what really faith is, because you're surrounded by unbelief. And real faith is just going to be unmoved, steadfast upon the word of God, unchanging and immovable. The word of God has said it. That's what I'm believing. Thank you very much. God's faithful. And we're just going to keep standing our ground. So I'm glad to hear he said that. That just thrills my heart. More need to hear it. He's one of the ones I recommend. You know, listen to Keith Moore. You know, people have different flavors. I'm not everybody's flavor. I know that. You know, sometimes just the tone of your voice or gestures. I don't know. Sometimes you might remind somebody of a person that hurt them in the past. And just the way you look has a bad memory. Or you might remind somebody of, you know, you remind me of my grandfather, and I just love my grandfather. Well, they love me because I remind them of their grandfather. I'm not anything like their grandfather, except for I look a little like him, so they love me. But I might remind, so I may not be everybody's flavor. So, well, if you don't want to listen to this ministry, listen to Keith Moore. And if he's not your flavor, then pick up on Mark Hankins. Or, you know, find somebody that, and there's not that many that I really recommend. But I'm glad to hear that there are those of like precious faith, following and carrying on what the Lord told Brother Hagin to do. Go to teach my people what I've taught you. Go teach my people faith. Most ministers are just perpetuating unbelief. And it's sad. They love the Lord. And even in their ministry, they'll have healings and miracles and answers to prayer. But by and large, it'll be for new people. Very often it's new people. A new message to new people. if you had a noise in your car, you might go to a mechanic and say, listen to this, and he can just listen to it and tell you what's wrong. You've heard this noise, and you're riding along, you know, going down the road, you hear a noise or a ping or a clump or a thud or a, you know, and you take a mechanic. Sometimes he doesn't even have to drive it. You can just describe it, and he knows what it is. I believe there are spiritual mechanics. It's good when we can hear somebody, you know, situation, and then somebody, a spiritual mechanic, be able to say, what's wrong? Here's what's wrong, and here's what you need to fix. This is where you're missing it, or this is what's wrong. Here's where you need to fix it. When people are not getting results, something's wrong. And it's good for people to be able to locate what's wrong and not continue beating their head against the wall and listening to ministers that are embalmed with unbelief and perpetuating traditions of men and keep doing the same old thing without getting any results. And so most ministers would be busy praying for the doctor's report to be good. We're going to pray for a good doctor's report. There are very few. And to hear Keith Moore say that is a blessing, a thrill to my heart. Somebody asked me one time, Brother Tony, do you feel alone out there? And at the time, more so than maybe at other times, I said, sometimes I do. Because you're speaking some things that sometimes you feel like nobody else is saying. Amen. But it's good to hear that there are others that are saying some of the same things. Amen. I've got somebody who's with me. I'm not alone. Amen. We need to have ministers that are teaching faith and what pleases God and not being moved by circumstances. Paul shook it off in the fire. He felt no harm. And the way that that becomes a part of you is to meditate on it. Here's something I heard a long time ago, many years ago. There was a basketball coach, and he told part of his team to relax, take a break, take some time off, don't do anything, don't even think about basketball. And then he told another part of his team, take some time off, don't come to the gym, don't come to the court, don't come to a practice. We're not going to have practice. We're going to take time off. But every day I want you to spend an hour imagining that you're throwing free throws. Imagine it. Do that for an hour every day. Imagine you're throwing free throws. Imagine it. Every day for at least an hour, just imagine in your mind that you're throwing free throws every day, every day. Well, at the end of the period where they took time off, the group that had imagined every day that they were throwing free throws were better at throwing free throws than the other group that didn't do anything related to basketball. Now, neither of them actually came to the basketball court and threw any free throws, but the group that had imagined it were better at it. If that'll work in the natural, it'll work in the spiritual. You have to meditate on the blessing. You have to see yourself walking in the light of God's word. You have to see it on the inside being fulfilled in you. You have to imagine it. You have to imagine yourself running to Goliath. You have to imagine yourself shaking the serpent off in the fire. You have to imagine yourself picking up the ear and putting it back on the soldier. You have to imagine yourself walking in the supernatural, or you'll likely never walk in the supernatural. You have to imagine yourself having victory over COVID-19, where you boldly proclaim, it'll never come to me. If it tries, I'll shake it off and it'll leave. You have to imagine being supernatural instead of natural. You have to answer the problem with the answer. You have to answer the natural with the supernatural. You have to answer the fear of what the world would say with the faith of the Word of God. Quote scripture to yourself as an answer to every situation that might be presented in the world. This is what the world says. This is what the Word of God says. And they say this is incurable. By whose stripes I was healed. Himself took my infirmities and bare my sicknesses. Jesus Christ maketh me whole. You have to imagine yourself having victory. I mean, if you can imagine yourself throwing free throws and be better at it without even touching a basketball, without even throwing the basketball, just imagine that you're better at it than you were and get better than you were just using your imagination. If that'll work in the natural. And see, I heard that years ago. I don't know if maybe I've not shared that as often as I should. I've been remiss. But I heard that years ago, and I began to put that to practice as a spiritual truth, and I think on victory. I imagine myself, what would I do if a snake bit me? Well, I imagine myself acting like Paul did in Acts chapter 28. Just shake it off in the fire. And that, I roll that over in my mind. I role play. I don't know about you, but I role play. I mean, in the nighttime when it's all quiet and everything is still, I'm meditating on the Word of God. And I'm role playing. I'm seeing myself in situations. What would I do? Well, what does the Word of God say? What are different examples that I've read about in the Word of God? What did they do? Then I imagine myself doing that too. If it's for me, if it's for the body of Christ, if it's for the children of God, then I imagine myself doing that and having those results. And the more you do that, the more you're prepared when something similar like a snake bite or a spider bite, three spider bites on your back, then you just go ahead and do what you've imagined yourself doing if you were bit by a snake. I've never been bit by a snake. What would you do? Well, I plan to do exactly what Paul did. I plan to do exactly what I did when the spiders bit me. Because somebody said, well, I don't know about that. Then you're not ready. You're not ready. If you wonder, you're not ready. You've got to imagine it to where it's so big on the inside that that's your knee-jerk reaction. That's what you do out of your spirit. Your mind can go tilt, but you've developed it into your spirit so big that that's how you react. And when it gets big on the inside, you run toward Goliath. Well, I'm not there yet, but I'm growing. And I'm not where I want to be, but I'm better than I used to be, and I'm further along than I once was. How do you do this? You imagine it. You see it. You meditate the Word of God. God told Joshua in chapter 1, meditate the Word of God day and night. Why? So you'll do it. So you'll do it. So you'll do it. Joshua 1:8, meditate the Word of God day and night. Why? So you'll do it. Well, can't I just do the Word of God when it presents itself to me and when the opportunity, when the circumstance, if you've not been meditating on it, What's in you is going to come out of you. But if you meditate on the Word of God and put it in you and put it in you and put it in you and put it in you, then when there's a demand made, it comes out of you. And you do it. And that's what God told Joshua in chapter 1 and verse 8, so that you'll observe to do it. Because then you make your way prosperous and you have good success. Meditate the Word of God day and night, so that thou mayest observe to do all things whatsoever have been commanded, and then you'll make your way prosperous. Then you'll have good success. And when the spiders bite you, when the serpent bites you, when somebody comes along and cuts somebody's ear off, you respond in the spirit realm because you've seen yourself doing it before you ever did it. Yes, they saw themselves throwing free throws. They saw themselves doing it. And then when they came to the basketball court and put the basketball actually in their hand, they were better at it than the other crowd that the coach said, don't even think about basketball. He was wanting to do an experiment. And I'm so glad that he did. And I'm so glad I heard about it because I related it to spiritual truth. If that'll work for basketball, it'll work for victory in Jesus Christ. And isn't that the same thing that God told Joshua to do? Meditate on throwing free throws day and night. And then when you're ready to throw free throws, you'll have success. Isn't that what God told Joshua? Meditate on throwing free throws day and night. So then when you're ready to throw some free throws, you'll have success. But if you don't meditate on it, then when the opportunity presents itself, you won't be ready. So when the COVID-19 or the virus or anything that you just already in advance, you're saying, well, they say that this is deadly. They say this is forever. They say this is incurable. Well, I'm different because the Word of God is said.
by whose stripes I was healed. Himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Jesus Christ maketh me whole. I'm staying with it until I have the victory. The doctor's report has nothing to do with it. I don't care what it says. I mean, I want a good report so I can tell the testimony, but if I don't have a good report, I'm just going to keep at it. And really, I couldn't care less what the doctor's report is, except I want a good testimony, and I'm going to have one. It may not be tomorrow or next week, but I'm going to have one. Amen. Can somebody say amen? God is faithful. The armed forces, the reason they drill it into you is so it's just second nature or first nature. I'm not sure why it's second nature. It ought to be first nature. But it's, the knee-jerk reaction. It's not coming out of your head. It's coming out of your heart because it's been drilled into you. And that's why they want it drilled into you. Because in adversity, under pressure, the mind is designed by God to move out of the way. God designed it that way. Under pressure, the mind is designed by God to step out of the way and let the heart come to the forefront. And what's in the heart will come out of the mouth, and what's coming out of the mouth from the heart, not the head, the heart, not the head, the heart, not just a little bit, but in abundance, will cause circumstances to line up. They tell me that pilots, before they crash into the side of the mountain, the black box, the voice recorder, the cockpit recorder, they tell me that the vast majority of the time there's cursing. What good does that do? We're about to plow into the side of this mountain. Let's curse. It's not logical, but that's what's in their heart. And that's what comes out of their mouth. And it does not do anything good. It is destructive, so they have destruction. It's not a supernatural victory. It's not supernatural where the plane is lifted up and there's no explanation because the angels got involved, because faith was released, because that's not what's in their heart. But if you put that in that pilot's heart to where the mind cannot respond to this pressure, and the mind steps out of the way and lets the heart do it, and the heart is filled with the faith of the Word of God, what will come out of the heart of that pilot will be glory to God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. We're having victory. We're rising up. And that'll come from the heart, not the head, not because somebody said, now have a good confession, brother. It'll be because it's been built in there. And it'll control the circumstances. And then we'll have a testimony. Amen. But why are they cursing? They're not logically thinking about it. It's what's in the heart, and the mind steps out of the way, and what's in the heart comes out. Well, if we'd put the right thing in our heart, the right thing will come out of our heart. And if we have the right thing coming out of our heart, it comes out of our mouth. And death and life are in the power of the tongue. And we'll have life instead of death if it's from the tongue that's touched and releasing the abundance of the heart. Then that's what we'll experience. So build the Word of God in your heart by meditation before you need it. And then it doesn't matter what the doctor's report is. You just have that attitude. You know, I'm going to the doctor, but I really don't care what it is. I'm looking for a good report. But if it's not today, it'll be next time. But I'm going to keep doing this till I get a good doctor's report, and because I'm going to have a good testimony. But I'm not going to be moved either way. And really, I couldn't care less what it is, other than I'm looking to tell a good testimony. Amen. That's how it works. A lot of Christians just believe it's all up to God, and they're begging and pleading and praying and hoping that maybe God will see fit to do something for them. And everybody keep praying because apparently God hasn't done it yet. The doctor says so, and he's the one we believe. I mean, if he says that it's still there, then it must still be, and God hasn't done it yet, so we're still trying to get God to do it. Everybody keep praying. Well, God has mercy, and he winks at ignorance for a time. He overlooks some things. There are things that children can receive without knowing much in the natural and the spiritual. But as we grow or should grow, God won't put up with that anymore. He wants us to walk by his word and faith in his word, not by sight, not by what we feel or see or hear from someone else other than his word. It's another voice. It's not the word of God. It's another voice. And it's not supernatural. It's natural. The doctor is given a natural report. Well, whose report are you going to believe? To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Whose report? The ones that that believe the report of the word of God, then they'll receive the strong arm of God and the long arm of God and the victorious arm of God. Whose report are you going to believe? Well, that's Isaiah chapter 53, verse 1. If it asks us the question, whose report are you going to believe? Then it must be that we have more than one report. If it's asking us which one we're going to believe, if there was only one report, there'd be no reason to ask us which one we're going to believe. So we've got a supernatural report, but we don't need to be asked which one we're going to believe unless we also have a natural report. And God will let us experience both reports because the question has been presented. Now, which one are you going to believe? And multitudes are believing the wrong report. And they're coming to church and asking for prayer again and again. Why? Because they believe the wrong report. Well, I went to the doctor this week and he said it's still there. Well, they demonstrate that they believe that report by asking for prayer. You can tell what they believe by listening to what they say and watching what they do. I just don't want to, throw them all out of the water all at one time. So we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient toward all men. That's good scripture to keep in mind and keep in your heart when you're dealing with people, because there's different kinds of people. Some are unruly, some are feeble-minded, some need your patience because they're weak. And so I just don't want to blast everybody out of the water. They'll come in and they'll say, well, I had a bad doctor's report, pray for me. Well, I consider who's asking. If this is somebody new, they don't know any better, they've not been taught, I might want to comfort them and support them. But if it's somebody that's heard the teaching, they've heard me, they've heard Keith Moore, they've heard the teaching for 2 or 3 years and they're still asking that, I might want to just blast them out of the water. I mean, let's just have an explosion right now. Stop that unbelief. We're not going to pray that prayer. And I don't want you to be moved by that prayer. And why are you being moved? Jesus, on more than one occasion, would ask, why are you, why do you doubt? Peter's sinking, and Jesus asked him, why did you doubt? They're going across, let us pass over and go to the other side. And they woke him up because they were afraid. And Jesus said, why is it that you don't have any faith? And then he said, if God's going to clothe the grass of the field, and if he's going to take care of the birds, he said, oh, ye of little faith. There's occasion where Jesus just pointed it out. It's your doubt. Why couldn't we cast the devil out? It's your unbelief. Why are we struggling? Because you have little faith. And so sometimes you just want to tell people, that's unbelief. Stop that. Well, I heard the doctor and he said this, that's unbelief. Stop that. Amen. And then it also, here's the flip side. Here's the flip side of that coin. Somebody comes in and has a good doctor's report and people in your midst want to go praise the Lord. You're praising the Lord because of the report. And that's still putting the emphasis on the report. Does anybody see that besides me? Whether it's a bad report or a good report, if your reaction is to the report, your focus is on the wrong thing. Well, it's a bad report. Everybody keep praying. It's a good report. Praise the Lord. You're still responding to the report. Does anybody else see that? God doesn't want you to respond to the report, the natural report. He wants you to be responding to the report of his word and being steadfast. You've been praising the Lord before the doctor's report agreed. Keep that praise active and don't let it change. You shouldn't be praising the Lord anymore when the doctor says it's all gone than you were before the doctor said it was all gone. The spiritual report ought to be where the praise is. So the flip side to that coin, somebody comes in and says, well, the doctor says it's still there. Keep praying. If it's somebody young in the Lord and weak in the faith, I might have a little bit of patience and comfort. But if somebody that's heard this message for a while, I want to tell them, shut up. And And then somebody else comes in the flip side. Well, I went to the doctor and they said it's all gone. And people go, praise the Lord. And I just want to, same thing. Now, if it's weak in the faith or young in these things, I might have some comfort, you know, comfort the feeble-minded, patient to the weak. But if they've heard this message for 2 or 3 years or whatever, I sometimes want to say, shut up. Don't put your patience on the report. I mean, your praise on the report. Is anybody listening to me? Don't put your attention on the report. Don't put your attention on the report. Good or bad. We don't move. We don't move. We don't move. We're praising the Lord because of the word of God. And when they come in and say, the doctor says it's all gone, then it's just matter of fact. Well, praise God. We knew that. But see, the praise God is the same praise God that they should have if they came in and said, well, the doctor says it's still there. Well, praise God. We know what God's word says. It's still praise God either way. Are you hearing me? It's praise God either way. I mean, we want to praise the Lord and we want to have a good report. But the praise should be instead of the report. It should be with the report, but instead of the report. Now we have a good report and we can give the testimony, but we're praising God either way. I've lived this way for 40 years. Don't be moved by what you see. Don't be moved by what you feel. Don't be moved by the report. And the cheers or the jeers, don't be moved. Don't be moved to anxiety and fear. Don't be moved to undue praise. The same praise that you had before the report ought to be what you have after the report. Well, thank God. We knew that. We expected that. Now we can tell the testimony and tell people that don't know anything about God and His word and His faith. We can tell them the testimony. Go home and tell your friends how great things the Lord hath done for thee and hath had compassion on thee. Jesus told him to go tell it. And he's telling it to people that need to hear something they've never heard before. But those who are of like precious faith ought to be among those that are, matter of fact, well, of course. They prayed for me. They anointed me with oil. They prayed in the name of Jesus. The anointing went in me. I've received the word of God, and I went to the doctor. He said it got worse, but I kept quoting the Bible and believing God's word. I went to the doctor. He said it's some better, but I kept going to the word of God and quoting the Bible and believing I'd received, and I went to the doctor, and the doctor said it's all gone. When people who know faith hear that, it ought to just be, well, that's the way it works. Praise, it's praise God, but it's praise God each step of the way. It's the same praise God each step of the way. Well, I went to the doctor and he said it's worse. Well, praise God. The word's still working in you regardless of what you hear them say. It's praise God. Well, I believed I received my healing. Praise God. Well, I went and he said it's worse. Well, praise God. God's word is working. Well, he said it's some better. Well, praise God. That's the way it works. Well, he said it's all gone. Well, praise God. That's the way it works. It's praise God every step of the way. Notice the praise didn't get any greater, any more jubilant when the doctor said it's all gone. If so, put a monitor, put a watch over your mouth, put a monitor over your spirit and over your mind. If that's what happens to you, then you're putting more attention on the doctor's report than you are God's report. Amen. That's right. It's hard sometimes to get that across to people, especially when they've heard the contrary for 40 years. It's hard sometimes to change people that have heard their own teaching for decades. Amen. But faith in God is regardless of the circumstances. We walk by faith and not by sight. What does that mean? Anything else. Anything else. We walk by faith and not by anything else. When we have the answer, it's the tree of life. There's a natural side of this. Your natural side is happy. I can be turning cartwheels on the inside when in the natural, it's not that way. And so there's a natural. Jesus said, I leave you peace, not as the world leaves. And he said, ask and
you receive, that your joy may be full. So he wants you to have full joy. But it's not the same as the world any more than the peace is the same as the world. Now, when you have the natural peace and the natural joy too, then that's both. But the spirit realm is where the power is. He's able to do exceeding abundantly above all we ask or think according to the power that works in us. And that power that works in us is the power of faith, the work of faith with power. It's the kingdom, the word. And the joy is the strength, and count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations. There is a natural side. And so you don't need to feel condemned or something's wrong if you experience some natural joy when the answer comes. But if you're monitoring your spirit, the praise was there before the answer came. And it should be just a matter of fact. That's the way it works. I'm glad that we finally got it. But we expected it because that's the way it works. But it ought not be, well, the doctor's report says it's all gone. Glory, 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 praise the Lord. And it's putting the emphasis on the doctor's report. I believe we ought to monitor that and make sure that we have. Abraham in Romans chapter 4 was strong in faith, giving glory to God before he had a good doctor's report. And I don't know that he changed. I mean, he was glad when Isaac was born. I'm sure there was some joy and jubilation. But he was giving glory to God beforehand. So monitor your own emotions. Faith is not an emotion. It'll produce emotions, but it's not the result of. You know, one can produce something else, but it's not the result of what it produces. Faith can produce joy, but it's not produced by joy. Faith can produce emotions, but it's not the result of emotions. So I can have all kinds of emotions. I need to know the difference. We have to know the difference between spirit and emotion. God is not moved by emotion. When he laughs, it's not emotion. When he dances, it's not emotion. When he sees his children dance, it's not emotion. The joy of the Lord is not emotion. I think it's not been taught the way it should. The Bible says in James chapter 1 that the wrath of man does not work the righteousness of God. Wrath there means emotion. And that's the negative side, but it's true on the positive side. The emotion of man is not what stirs God. And it's like God couldn't care less if you're mad about something. He's not mad when you're mad. And he's not happy when you're happy. Because emotion doesn't move God. It's hard to get that across to some people. Because especially when they're emotional, they think God is too. He laughs, but that's not an emotion. He has joy, but that's not emotion. And if there were to be a smile on his face, it's not the emotion that we might think of when we smile. Faith is not an emotion. Faith may produce emotions, but faith on the inside can turn cartwheels when all of circumstances seem against you. And then when the answer comes, it's a tree of life because you have it, but on the inside, you're already rejoicing. And if people who know faith are hooked in with you, when the answer comes, it'll be a tree of life for them too. But they were already hooked into praise. And if the casual observer may not even notice the difference because they were already praising the Lord. I'm enjoying these tomatoes, and it was work while I was out there tending to them. And now I can finally slice one and put it on some bread with mayonnaise and salt and pepper, and it tastes good. But I was tasting them when I was in the field. I already saw it coming. And that's why they're working. That's why they're working. I mean, if you don't have some expectation of the fruit of your labor, then you may not be very diligent in your work. That's why we're working. And praise stills the enemy and the avenger. The joy of the Lord is our strength, and we're to count it all joy when we're in adversities. None of these things are emotion. Faith is not an emotion. Faith is not based on emotion. Faith is not moved by emotion. God doesn't care when you're mad at somebody. Show me a scripture where it's not anger. James chapter 1 says the wrath of man doesn't work the righteousness of God. What does that mean? Your wrath does not move God. Well, if that's true of wrath, wouldn't it be true of happiness? It's hard to get that across to some people. It's not an emotion, and emotion doesn't move God. In Hebrews chapter 12, Jesus endured the cross, despising the shame, the contradiction of sinners, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him, it says, lest you get weary and you faint in your own minds, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. He endured the cross because of joy that was coming. What was the joy? The joy was seeing the family, the fulfillment of the word of God, the redemption that was coming by his resurrection and his precious blood. And that brought him joy, not an emotion. And see, emotional people think God's emotional because they're emotional. God must be emotional because he's like me. But he's not emotional, and he's not moved by emotion. I mean, I have emotion, so it's not that I may be in the same situation other people are too. I have to realize that God is not moved by my emotion. God's not happy when I'm happy. He's not sad when I'm sad. Would he be sad? Is he sad? Does he have any blue Mondays or gray Tuesdays? Is he thrilled when it's finally Friday? Is he? Isn't the word of God the same all the time? He's touched with the feeling of our infirmities. He has compassion. That's not emotion. There's a lot of difference. There's a big difference between compassion and sympathy. There's a big difference between joy and giddiness. Joy is strength. Joy is on the inside turning cartwheels. I can have joy without a smile on my face. Now, I like smiles, and I like the circumstances to produce smiles. But if I'm waiting for my faith to kick in when I get the smile, and I think God is finally happy when I get the answer, then I've missed the essence of faith and the power of joy. Just meditate on these things. Joy is a powerful, powerful force. The joy of the Lord is not an emotion. If you're waiting to have happiness before your faith works, you're missing it. You're missing it. You're missing it. You're missing it. I've got to have joy regardless of happiness. I've got to have joy regardless of a smile on my face. Now, don't misunderstand me. I like smiles. I'd rather smile than frown. I'd rather be in situations that cause me to smile than situations that cause me to frown. But my joy must be immovable. Paul said it in Philippians chapter 4. When he said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, that's what he's talking about. He said, I know how to abound. I know how to be abased. I know how to be full. I know how to suffer need or be hungry. I know what to do. I can do all things through Christ. On another occasion, he said, none of these things move me. So when you get a hold of the faith of the word of God and follow examples like Paul, then you'll also have the attitude, none of these things move me. And whether I am a suffering need or abounding, whether I am abased or being, you know, blessed, whether I'm hungry or full. Philippians 4:12, did you put it up, Susan? I know both how to be abased. I know how to abound. Everywhere at all these things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things. That's these things. Through Christ, which strengthens me. So he's saying whether situations make me want to smile or frown, I'm the same on the inside. People have to get a hold of this. You've got to be the same on the inside. Whether a situation causes me to smile or frown, I have to be the same on the inside.
And God's not moved by the situation that's causing me to smile. God's not moved by the situation that's causing me to frown. God's moved by the word of God that should cause me to be the same on the inside. And he wants me to be immovable, just like he's immovable. He walks by faith, not by sight. And when whatever situation comes against me, I can say, I respond to that by faith, not by sight. Now, I may be frowning and I'd rather smile. And I'd rather come in and say, the doctor says it's all gone. But I want to be mixed with people of like precious faith that are immovable. It may be the answer comes and it's a tree of life. And when it's deferred, it makes the heart sick. And that's old covenant. And we don't have the full import of that until we come over into the new covenant. But it's still, I want to be around people that are still giving glory to God and being fully persuaded that what he promised he's able to perform. And God's not moved by the cheers or the jeers. He's not moved by the frowns or the smiles. He's not moved by whether I'm unhappy or happy. He's not moved by whether I'm unhappy or happy. God is not moved by whether I'm unhappy or happy. And he wants me to be immovable. That's why Paul said, I know what to do. Let's read it again. Philippians 4:12. Paul said, I know both how to be abased or what to do when I'm abased. And I know how to abound or what to do when I abound. I know what to do. Everywhere and in all things I'm instructed both to be full or what to do when I'm full. And I know what to do when I'm hungry. I know what to do when I abound. And I know what to do when I suffer need. What do you do? Well, all of these things, I do them through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Because God knows what to do. And in me, he knows what to do. And whether I'm frowning or smiling, whether I have opportunities to have happiness or disappointment, God knows what to do. And I can do what God knows to do. I can do all these things through Christ who strengthens me. And I know what to do. And I'm instructed. And what? Well, none of these things move me. I'm immovable, unshakable. Amen. Well, just shake it off in the fire. Just shake it off in the fire. Amen. Meditate on these things. This is foreign. 1 Corinthians 10:13, the same Paul wrote this, and I refer to it often. You know that I do. There's no temptation that's taken you or test or trial or adversity or calamity, tragedy of life, but such as is common to man, God's faithful. He won't allow you. Now, this is the person that's living according to, let's say, Psalm 91:1, abiding under the shadow, dwelling in the secret place. You're close to God. You're under the umbrella, and the umbrella is preventing you from getting wet. Get out from under that, and you get wet. It's not the umbrella's fault. But you dwell in the secret place, abide under the shadow. You're close with God, serving God, obeying God, in fellowship with God. Then he won't let anything happen, except you're able to bear it. With the test, the trial, the tragedy, the temptation, the adversity of life, he'll make a way to escape it so that you're able to bear it. And so I have this attitude. Whatever happens to me, if I will remind myself of this scripture, if I'll meditate on this scripture before I need it, if I'll see myself throwing free throws, then when the opportunity comes, I'll be better at it. If I'll meditate on this, then when the tragedy comes, this is what comes out of my heart. Well, this has happened to me. This adversity, this tragedy, this test, this trial, this tragedy has occurred. Well, don't you remember? God won't let anything happen but what you're able to bear it. So he already knows you can bear this. So I can handle it. I can handle it. I can handle it. Now, I may have a frown on my face. If somebody were to look at me, some disappointment, if somebody pinches me, I might go, ow. And there may be some test, trial, tragedy, adversity of life that brings an emotion. It may, you may feel pain if somebody hurts you.
Somebody sticks you with a needle, you feel pain, you don't laugh with joy. Is anybody listening to me? But on the inside, your response is different. So this has occurred, but I can count it all joy. I don't see, joy is not an emotion. You don't have to wait on feeling giddy. You can just say, ha, 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 and stir up the gift, stir up the joy. Count it all joy. Count it all joy. You wouldn't have to count it joy if it already was joy. You count it as joy because it's not on its own. Count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations, tests, trials, adversities. Because God's faithful and he's not going to let anything happen but what I'm able to bear. So I'm able to bear this. I'm able to bear it. So on the inside, I'm giving glory to God because I'm fully persuaded that he's able to do what he's promised, what he's provided. And if I'm staying with him, let the weak say I'm strong. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The weak in Christ, that the power, I'm weak, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. And so I'm strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And the joy is not an emotion. It may produce emotions. Later, it's a tree of life, and you may see me cheerful and giddy and happy. But God was just as full of faith and joy and praise and the knowledge of his word and being unshakable and immovable before I experienced the answer. God was. I said God was. I said God was. And if I'm going to hook in with him, I'm going to be like that too. That's why Paul said, I know what to do when I'm full. I know what to do when I'm hungry. What? I do the same thing. Just to look at me, you can't tell the difference. Is he full or is he hungry? We can't tell. Did he get a good doctor's report or a bad doctor's report? We can't tell. That's where you want to be. Did you hear me? Philippians 4:12. We can't tell by looking at him. Is he full or hungry? We can't tell. Did he get a good doctor's report or a bad doctor's report? We can't tell. The three Hebrew children came out of the fiery furnace. Did they just come out of a fiery furnace? We can't tell. Is that right? The ropes are gone. I think some Christians, they ought to get rid of that bondage. That's what they ought to get rid of. But while they were in the fire, they were praising God. Now, I'm sure it was a tremendous testimony for them to tell, and they were glad to tell it. But the praise of God was the same. And that's where we have to be, where we're not moved. I'm throwing free throws in my mind and in my heart. And so get me to the court, the basketball court, and put the basketball in my hand, and I'll be better at it. Imagine it, and you'll have praise on the inside. Now, when you actually get on the court and you win the game, there's a thrill to that. But the reason that you're ready for the game is because you've already been imagining it. And there's just all of these metaphors and allegories. Just find one that suits you and hook into it. Faith is not an emotion. It's not moved by emotion. It may produce them, but it's not moved by them. God is not moved by your disappointment. Not why he loves me, he cares for me. People want to believe that. He does love you. He does care for you, but he's not moved by that. So people want to believe that. God's going to take care of me because he loves me. People want to believe that. But Jesus taught it differently. Remember where the one said, friend, lend me three loaves because a friend of mine in his journey has come at midnight. I have nothing to serve them. Lend me three loaves. Because a friend in their journey has come and I don't have anything to serve them. You remember? And Jesus said, he will not rise because he's a friend. Did he say that? He won't rise because he's a friend. And Jesus is talking about what God is like. Everybody say, this is what God is like. Jesus is talking about what God is like. And Jesus said, like God, this person won't get up because he's a friend. But he will
because of importunity, he'll get up and give him as much as he needs. And God will be moved by boldness. God is not moved by the emotion. God is not moved by, well, he loves us, he's going to take care of us. God's a faith God. He's not any other kind of God. You may love him and he may love you, but he won't take care of you except by faith. Now, young children are different. He'll treat young children, babies, the way we treat young children and babies. But when we grow or should grow, we expect more. And in the spirit realm, God wants us to grow. And when we should grow or have grown, he expects more. So things are different. But he's not moved by our love for him, per se. You know, Hebrews 11:6 doesn't say it's impossible to please him without love. Now, love's important, don't misunderstand me, but what does it say there? Without faith, it's impossible to please him. God's a faith God. He's not any other kind. We must approach God because we believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. It's impossible to please him without faith. Well, I believe God's going to take care of me because he loves me. And I love him, and I've just been praising him, and he's going to take care of me. Well, praise stills the enemy and the avenger because it's the language of faith. But faith comes by his word, is immovable, unshakable, and stands its ground. I know what to do. I know what to do. I know what to do. Why? Paul said in Philippians 4:12, he said it, he made it clear. I've been instructed. I've been instructed. Faith comes by hearing, and faith comes by instruction. And now I know what to do. God is not moved by just the fact that I have a need, but he'll be moved because I'm instructed, and I'll do what I've been instructed to do, and I can do these things. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So see yourself throwing free throws. See yourself acting on the word of God before it ever happens. And then when it does happen, Goliath is there in front of you and you're running toward him. And God is moved by that. You know, the whole army, the armies of Israel were in fear and it didn't move God one bit. Goliath was so big and strong, and these are God's children, God's people that the enemy has come against. And none of that moved God one bit. What moved God? When David came along and began to talk faith, that moved God. God is not need-minded as much as seed and the seed of his word. He'll move according to his word, and he'll do what he said he'll do in your life, in your heart, when you take him at his word. He watches over his word to perform it, and it's not based on your emotion or his. It's not based on how he cares for you and you've praised him enough, and he's so glad now and happy. Can somebody say amen? The wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. That's referring to the emotion of man doesn't move God. Paraphrase it this way. The emotion of man does not move God. And then just meditate on that for an hour or two a day. And then you'll see your own emotion in a different light. God couldn't care less what my emotion is. He's not looking for the joy that the world gives. He's not looking for the peace that the world gives. He said, my peace I leave with you, not as the world gives, give I unto you. My peace. And it's on the inside, regardless of what the world is doing. It's not emotion. And I have emotion. Don't misunderstand me. It's not like I don't know what emotion feels like. I just know it doesn't move God. And God doesn't respond to it. Amen. Amen. Faith is an entirely different thing. And if you can get that across to people, then when they're in a trial, you can't tell the difference. They come in and you can't tell if they're in a trial or they got a good report. You can't tell. Because they're entering his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. You know, I know the Bible says, you that are, afflicted, pray. You that are merry, sing psalms. That's true, all right.
But put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Let the weak say I'm strong. You need to know that you qualify. But I'm going to purpose to count it all joy. And if I do that, others that are watching maybe won't even tell the difference. I'm going to enter his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise. I'm going to put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. And the casual observer, if they don't perceive in the spirit to hook in with me because I'm under pressure, if they're just going by the outward observation, they won't be able to tell the difference. If I'm doing it right, of course, no one does perfectly, but I'm headed that way. But I do know that my emotion does not move God. God's moved by what? Faith.